brought to you by DK Audio.
DK Audio presents The Science of Gardening, written and read by Dr. Stuart Farrimond. Introduction. It's taken me 40 years to discover the joy of gardening. Not since sowing a handful of cress seeds into a compost-filled plastic cup at the age of 6 had I felt the thrill of seeing perfectly formed green life emerge from brown dirt. But my adult hands, softened from years of tapped keys and pushed pencils, had once again made this miracle happen on a kitchen windowsill. It didn't matter that only 3 of my 30 Brussels sprout seeds made it and that their crop was tiny. A gate had been opened into my heart and mind, into a world I was keen to explore. Gardening is the perfect antidote to doom-scrolling through today's news. It reconnects us with the perpetual cycle of life, death, and renewal, of which we are all a part. In fact, I can think of no other pursuit that offers more. Whether you have a balcony or a small holding, growing plants allows you to be a designer, sculptor, artist, wonderstruck child, an inquisitive scientist with ever more to learn. And yet for something as beautifully simple as sowing, planting and watering, we humans have made gardening terribly complicated. Trained as a medical doctor, I know only too well how to bamboozle others with technical terms. And now, as a gardener, I was being befuddled by a forest of gobbledygook and strange rituals. What is a perennial? What on earth is mulching? Why mustn't I water plants in the middle of the day? Our adult egos make us embarrassed to ask. But old handle rookie, I'm willing to wager you've been confused by Latin names, a mysterious term, or perhaps wondered whether you really need to put crocks in the bottom of your plant pots. Most gardening books and websites are missing a trick. They explain the hows of growing and plant care without even touching on the whys. As a man of science whose passion is to demystify and debunk, I've taken delight in using science and the latest research to answer key gardening questions and reveal why some age-old practices belong in the past. In the book that follows, I will reveal to you the science behind the how when caring for plants and hope that informs and inspires your gardening in the same way it has mine. Before we start, here's a reminder of some terms that come up often in this book. Annual. These are plants that germinate, grow, reproduce, and die in one calendar year. This live fast and die young strategy evolved to take advantage of short growing seasons in inhospitable places. Biennial, meaning every 2 years, flower in their second growing season and then they die. The first growing season is used to build up the resources needed to flower and produce seeds. Perennial. Around 90% of all plants are perennial, the word means through the year, which do not die after flowering and can live for many years, sometimes indefinitely. Deciduous. These are perennial plants that deliberately dump their leaves in autumn to reduce energy loss and risk of damage to the plant during winter. Evergreen. These are plants that keep their leaves throughout the year, not to be confused with conifers, which are cone-bearing plants that sometimes lose their leaves. Herbaceous, this is the definition of soft stem plants with no woody tissue. Because wood takes time to build, all annuals and biennials are herbaceous, but many perennials are too. Woody, plants with stiff, bark-covered stems which support new growth year after year. It's made from compressed plant fibres called cellulose, held together by a powerful glue called lignin. All woody plants are perennial. Part 1. Wonder of Gardening. How amazing are plants? Here are just a few of the remarkable ways in which plants have evolved to survive and thrive, making their own food, duping animals into transporting their pollen, and regenerating parts that have been eaten. Plants give us every breath of oxygen that fills our lungs, make their own food out of thin air in a process called photosynthesis, and are the original source of every mouthful we eat. They are the linchpin of all life on Earth and the ultimate survivors, managing to thrive in even the harshest conditions in practically every corner of the globe. Trees can weigh in over 2,000 tons and can live to be over 5,000 years old. Some great basin bristlecone pine trees, Pinus longiva, were alive even before the Egyptian pyramids were built. At home in harsh climates, few organisms can survive minus 50 degrees C, that's minus 58 degrees Fahrenheit, yet plants have found a way. Moss campion, a type of cushion plant, hugs the ground as a squat dome to escape the worst of the wind. It happily survives on frozen mountainside under a blanket of snow, while biological antifreeze in its sap stops it freezing. In the parched deserts of southwest Africa, the seeds of alien-like welwitschia plants can wait for centuries until rainfall provides the right conditions for germination. In the Atacama Desert, where years can pass without rain, desert moss, Cintricia cananervis, stays alive by sucking moisture directly out of passing fog and mist. Air plants, Tillandsia, need no soil whatsoever, but use their wiry roots to cling to rocks, branches or cliff faces, pulling moisture directly from the air and harvesting nutrients by catching passing dust in their tiny leaf hairs called trichomes. Unsurprisingly, Tillandsia plants can be very slow growing. Dispersal and defense. Plants have overcome their inability to move in astonishing ways. Large bauble-shaped Brunsvigia is a type of tumbleweed whose flower head dries up, amputates itself, then rolls off in the breeze, dropping its seed. Javan cucumbers produce seeds shaped like gliders that, launched from their high vines, will soar for hundreds of meters. Dwarf mistletoes, Arcutobium, which grows parasites on trees, expand their range by expelling glue-coated seeds at 60 miles an hour, that's 97 kilometers an hour. As their fruits ripen, the flesh heats up rapidly, called thermogenesis, until the fruit ruptures and fires out seeds at high speed. Living in a world of hungry creatures means plants have developed some sophisticated defense systems to avoid being eaten. Cacti have evolved to defend their water-filled bodies from attackers by turning their leaves into sharp spikes, while succulents, known as living stones, lithops, hide in plain sight from thirsty animals by looking like pebbles. The deadly dynamite tree, Hura crepitans, has lethal sap that is used in poison darts and spreads its seeds with a bang. The tree's innocent-looking fruit is a grenade primed to explode. As it dries, tension builds up in the skin until eventually, with a tiny tap, the whole fruit breaks apart violently, each seed-loaded segment rocketing out at up to 156 miles an hour, that's 251 kilometers an hour. Seeds are dispersed and would-be predators get a nasty shock. Extraordinary adaptations. Plants have evolved countless ingenious ways to survive and flourish in every habitat, from lush rainforests to inhospitable deserts and mountainsides. Hura crepitans has a trunk studded with vicious spikes as just one of its defences. Dwarf mistletoes fire their seeds like bullets into neighbouring trees' bark. Rebutia has sharp spikes that deter predators but also help plants regulate temperature and water loss. Welwitschia grow very slowly in harsh desert conditions, but can live for over 1,500 years. Brunsvigia is a South African tumbleweed that disperses seeds as it's blown along by the wind. And Javan cucumbers have a melon-like fruit that release gliding seeds with paper-thin, 14 centimetres, that's 6 inches wide wings. Do plants have intelligence? We don't think of plants as having intelligence. They have no brain, after all. But how is it that our leafy friends are capable of many things that we usually think only creatures with intelligence can do? Believing that plants can hear our comforting words is sadly wishful thinking. Many of our ideas that plants have human-like smarts originated from the best-selling 1975 book, The Secret Life of Plants, in which dubious experiments supposedly prove that plants can read minds and become distressed at the sound of an egg cracking. These claims are fairy tales, but plants' real abilities are almost as extraordinary. We are blind to much of what plants do simply because they have a different timescale to us. A time-lapse film of a plant exploring its surroundings might almost be enough to convince you it is a thinking animal. Tendrils from climbing plants methodically grope around for a surface to cling to. Growing sunflower seedings swirl and dance with one another while tracking the sun. Plant roots probe and feel the soil like fingers. Sensing their surroundings. Nearly 150 years ago, Charles Darwin became convinced that root tips act as if they carry a tiny brain-like organ to make decisions. Long filed as a silly idea, research has since revealed that root tips have at least 15 senses. Sniffing air, tasting soil, sensing light and gravity, while using touch to avoid obstacles. Plants have no eyes, yet they can see light in different colours, thanks to microscopic light sensors called photoreceptors. These allow them to grow towards light and even twist to follow the sun before returning to face eastward at night time. Despite having no brain, plants can distinguish dawn from dusk and can even tell when they're shaded by other plants by the hue of the light striking their leaves. Without ears, plants can still detect the barely perceptible sound of a caterpillar munching a leaf and respond by infusing its leaves with insect-repelling chemicals. Roots can hear the burbling of a stream or pipe and steer their growth towards it. Touch sensors feel the breeze and promote stockier, stronger stems when plants are buffeted by wind. Plants remember past injuries and grow to prevent future damage. The sensitive plant, Mimosa pudica, curls its leaves for protection when touched, but will reduce its response to stimulus if no injury occurs. Communication skills. Like animals, all plants can smell and even have a nose for lurking danger. When under attack from an infection or pest, they emit aromas of distress, alerting neighbours and triggering their immune system to ready for battle. Fruits use ethylene gas as a ripening signal, so they ripen simultaneously for maximum appeal for passing animals. Plants are social and trees can actually communicate via the wood wide web, an underground mesh of what are called mycorrhizal fungi, which connect more than 60% of the world's trees to one another. Along these biological wires, nutrients and waters are shared between mother trees and saplings, as well as dying trees and their neighbours. Phototropism. Plants grow towards a light source, an ability called phototropism, to help them avoid the shade cast by neighbours and maximise the sunlight striking their leaves to power photosynthesis. Photoreceptor proteins sensitive to blue light wavelengths in the sunlight trigger this response. Straight stems and upright growth occur when sunlight strikes plants from above, bathing all the leaves evenly with blue light. Plants grow towards the light because shaded cells receive less blue light and elongate faster than those in the sun, causing the stem to bend towards light from the side. Passionflower is one of the many plants that uses tendrils to grasp supports. Tendrils actively search for hold and respond quickly when one is detected. Touch triggers cells to elongate on the outer surface of the tendril, which causes coiling. But to stop the plant twisting as a tendril tightens, each side of the uncoiled section coils in a different direction. Is gardening good for me? Medics have long taught to place their trust almost exclusively in medicines and scalpels. But times are changing, and soft treatments such as walks in the park, times by the sea, or a prescription of horticultural therapy are gaining ground. In a fast-moving world of quick fixes, gardening puts us back into the pace of life from which we evolved. plants grow and die over days, weeks, and seasons, a rate similar to that at which our minds learn, our bodies grow, and our wounds heal. Growth and healing. For those suffering or recovering from psychological trauma, the garden is a calm, protected space away from the stresses of life. Psychiatrists and psychologists have found that gardening offers a safe place to learn and care for something outside of ourselves when we have suffered from past hurts and traumas. Some plants can sting and have thorns, but they're never angry and will not bite back. Working in the garden provides a valuable opportunity for exercise, burning between 210 and 420 calories per hour, about the same as yoga or playing badminton, and cuts the risk of heart attack, stroke, and diabetes, helps avoid weight gain, improves self-esteem, and protects against stress and mental health issues. Down and dirty. There has long been a belief that playing in the dirt is good for kids. Since the late 1980s, some scientists have been saying that our obsession with sanitizing has resulted in the upswing in asthma, allergies, and eczema in children. Called the hygiene hypothesis, the theory states that if our immune system has not had exposure to harmful bacteria, viruses, and parasites from an early age, then it unwittingly targets harmless pollen, nut proteins, or dust mites, triggering in us allergic reactions. This hygiene hypothesis has never been proven conclusively, and while good sanitation and hand washing will always save more lives than it will cost, it will probably be good for us to get our hands grubby in the mud every once in a while. The instant you pick up a palm of soil, your skin is coated with an invisible balm of bacteria, and research shows that this mix of soil microbes may refresh and rejuvenate our skin's natural protective shield of bacteria, helping to calm an overactive immune system. While potentially protective on unbroken skin, keep any cuts, grazes, and inflamed areas clean and covered, because sinister bugs also lurk in the dirt. But more than this, bacteria from soil and vegetation actually suffuse the air above gardens and green spaces. Research shows that such microbes seem to give out anxiety-easing, mood-boosting vapours, and that those we swallow may help restore balance to our own gut bacteria, keeping our immune system strong and our digestion running smoothly. This is especially important for young children who need bacteria in the digestive tract to help stimulate the initial production of immune cells and their normal function. Remarkably, 70% of all immune cells are located in the gut. The closer we get to the earth and the weeds, the greater the number and diversity of these life-giving germs that waft over and through us. Compare this to the pollution-saturated air of our city streets and workspaces, and it's easy to see why we instinctively want to get down in amongst the dirt and the weeds, whether it's with a trowel or a Tonka truck in hand. Tending body and mind. Research increasingly supports the idea that gardening is among the most successful and cost-effective chemical-free solutions for our physical, mental, and emotional upkeep. On our skin, getting microbe-rich soil on our skin may help maintain a healthy immune system. In respiration, gardening provides gentle exercise to help maintain cardiovascular health. In our mind, caring for plants helps the mind deal with stress and recover from trauma. With vision, a green environment lowers stress and regulates levels of the stress hormone cortisol. And in our guts, airborne microbes in the garden help seed a healthy mix of gut bacteria, important for digestion and immunity. How important are gardens for wildlife? The unstoppable creep of concrete, metal, glass, and asphalt is pushing plant and animal life ever further to the margins. Whether it's a field or a window box, your garden can become a valuable green haven, teeming with a surprising diversity of life. In the US alone, every single minute, more than 3 acres of open green space is bulldozed or paved over. And without plants, there will be no wildlife. The plants in our garden give creatures big and small food, shelter, and a place to reproduce and raise their young. Decades of research has shown that even the plainest of gardens can be home to a galaxy of life. Over 8,000 species of insect alone were detected over a 30-year period in one modest-sized English garden. Researchers totting up the number of invertebrates, which are insects, worms, lice, millipedes, slugs, and snails, in urban and rural gardens across the world have found a similar richness of life everywhere they have looked. Whether it's a wide field or a window box, your garden can be a vital resource for wildlife, seen and unseen. Research shows that both small and large gardens can host a similar diversity of insect life. You decide what grows in your garden, and these choices can have a positive impact on the biodiversity that it supports. Gardening with wildlife in mind. Choose to plant flowers or trees that blossom and pollinators will buzz in from miles around to feed on their nourishing nectar and pollen. Plant a hedge or grow climbers at walls and fences and provide yet more flowers, along with cover and nesting sites for birds and shells for mammals and insects too. Berries and rose hips will feed birds and a water bath will give them and honeybees a place to drink. A small pond or area of standing water will give a breeding site for many insects, as well as frogs, toads, and newts. Leave some wood, twigs, and fallen leaves to rot down in one corner, and a legion of beetles, woodlice, ants, centipedes, fungi, and more will love you for it. A patch of uncut grass will offer up a mini jungle for all kinds of wildlife, providing you steer clear of weed killers and insecticides. Research shows that even immaculate lawns and pristine flowerbeds can be a valuable home for wildlife, with the rich soil a fertile land for earthworms and other soil organisms. Put simply, anything is better than concreting over your yard. Beneficial creatures. The other great news for gardeners is that encouraging wildlife into your plot has many perks. The songbirds, bats, shrews, toads, and hedgehogs that we love all rely on creepy crawlies as the main source of food and help keep the populations of snails, slugs, and insect plant pests under control. Some insects, like ladybirds and hoverflies, will also prey voraciously on the sap-sucking aphids that can plague new shoots in spring. Worms and an army of other invertebrates are just some of the decomposers that recycle dead plants and animals, fallen leaves, and all of nature's waste into nutrients that sustain plant growth. Flying invertebrates, bees, flies, wasps, beetles, moths, and butterflies pollinate over 80% of all flowering plants on Earth, enabling fruit and seed production and helping guarantee you a good crop of peaches, apples, and melons, to name but a few. Here are just some of the ways in which gardens can help support wildlife. Adjoining gardens in urban areas provide wild creatures with a habitat of unbroken green strips, called green corridors, while verges and parks act as stepping stones in between them. Cultivating gardens front and back and greening the street space helps keep these living corridors open for wildlife. A pond is the single greatest encouragement for wildlife any gardener can provide. Flowers growing in central reservations provide an important connecting strip of forage for pollinating insects. Leave grass unmown on verges to increase wildflowers and provide hiding places for animals. Pop-up parks in front of shops and cafes further green the streetscape, while front gardens turned into car parks create wildlife deserts. Wood piles create hideouts for insects and give food for fungi. Flowerbeds provide a banquet for bees and other pollinators. Hedges offer shelter and nesting sites. And encouragingly, public parks are increasingly managed with wildlife in mind. Can gardening help save the planet? As global temperatures inch higher and higher and weather becomes more extreme, the tsunami of man-made environmental catastrophes can feel overwhelming. Everyone who tends to a garden has a choice: be a part of the problem or a powerful driver of the solution. At no point in the last 65 million years, when an asteroid wiped out the dinosaurs, has the climate been changing as quickly as it is today. 250 years of burning fossil fuels, chainsawing forests, spilling toxic chemicals, ploughing fertile soils into dust, and draining the planet of its fresh water are now coming back to bite us. Choose plants that make a difference. Whether it be a window box or a spacious meadow, the way you use your little patch on the planet really can make a difference. A small balcony can be a flower-filled oasis in a desert of concrete, while a bigger rural garden can be an equally valuable resource among endless fields filled with a single crop. Pack your plots with sources of sugar-rich nectar year-round, and you'll help to feed populations of pollinating insects who've been struggling with the loss of their natural habitat and the widespread use of pesticides. Plants will thrive and need less attention when they are planted in the right spot. For example, growing plants that are adapted to arid conditions in the driest part of your garden will reduce the need for watering and so save on this increasingly precious commodity. Where you buy plants can also have environmental impact. Because you can choose plants propagated in a local nursery where you can ask the staff about their use of synthetic fertilizer and pesticides, or you can opt for mass-produced imported plants grown in heated greenhouses and transported hundreds of miles to the garden centre or DIY store shelves. Raising your own plants from seed minimises the cost to both you and the planet, giving you control over the resources while allowing you to enjoy the entire life of a plant. Value your green space. Garden design can matter too. Think very carefully before swapping real turf for plastic or concreting over your front garden to create driveways. For a start, concrete has a vast environmental cost. Making just 1 square metre of concrete can emit up to 260 kilograms, that's 575 pounds of carbon dioxide, equivalent to burning over 100 litres, that's 22 gallons of petrol. Such a choice also increases the risk of flooding for you and your neighbours. And it squanders the valuable potential of the plants and other life in your plot to capture carbon dioxide along with other harmful pollutants from the air and to cool your surroundings in hot summer weather. Life has an incredible ability to find a way, but there's a great deal you can do to stack the odds in its favour. Looking after your soil and growing plants that are welcoming to wildlife will mean that insects, birds, and many other creatures will make their way into your little sanctuary. The positive impact of your garden and your gardening will ripple out far further than you might ever have thought possible. Here are just some of the ways gardening can help save the planet. Trees will absorb carbon dioxide and pollution from passing traffic, while green roofs can be planted on carports and sheds. Permeable paving rather than solid paving reduces runoff after heavy rainfall. Flowering plants provide nectar for insects and boost your mood. Window boxes and climbers add planting to every available space, while hedges reduce air pollution and are valuable for wildlife. Conversely, prioritising parking over plants reduces the ability of gardens to absorb carbon dioxide, pollutants and rainfall. Bare walls and fences don't reduce air pollution or provide anything for wildlife, while solid paving causes runoff after rain, which can result in flooding. Do plants absorb pollutants from the air? 9 out of 10 of us live in air so polluted it is harming our health. Air pollution kills between 7 and 9 million people worldwide every year, and it causes heart and lung disease, stroke, diabetes, cancer, dementia, as well as headaches and anxiety. poisonous nasties floating in our air include the lung-damaging greenhouse gas nitrous oxide, toxic volatile organic compounds, or VOCs, and lethal invisible dust, known as particulate matter. Plants can't rid our streets and homes of these toxic fumes, but they can draw a sizable proportion of the pollution from exhausts and chimneys out of harm's way, meaning that a garden can have a particularly powerful positive impact if you live in a town or city. Natural air filters. Plants neutralize the harmful effect of some dangerous gases, such as nitrous and sulfur oxides, when they are taken in through the tiny pores on the undersides of leaves, called stomata, and they dissolve in the water within the leaf. Microscopic hair-like bristles called trichomes that coat plant leaves and stems effectively filter the air by trapping fine particulate matter, which is then washed away by rain. Species with small lobed leaves slow passing air and filter pollution most effectively. Conifers like Chinese juniper, Juniperus chinensis, with lots of small needle-like leaves are actually the best for purifying air. Nevertheless, all plants, even grass, will capture some air pollution. And the more you grow, especially between you and roads, the cleaner your air will be. While it's true that both leaves and microbes within plants absorb the pollution, these claims have been overblown. In reality, it would need an indoor jungle to absorb enough of the VOCs to make a real difference. But plants do bring many health benefits, including lifting mood and improving concentration and overall well-being. The leaves of different plants have a variety of features that allow them to catch and hold pollutants from passing air. When stomata, which are the pores on the underside of leaves, are open to exchange gases, they also take in and trap pollutants. Species with many small leaves create maximum air turbulence and have the largest pollution-capturing surface area. Plants with waxy leaves have a surface that is sticky enough to trap and retain fine particulate matter from the air, whereas plants with leaves that have fine hairs on them slow down airflow and capture the toxic particles contained in smoke and vehicle exhaust fumes. Can my garden capture and store carbon dioxide? It may not be possible to plant the estimated 700 to 1,000 trees annually that might be needed to offset all your carbon emissions, but you can plant and manage your plot in ways that maximize its ability to store and retain carbon dioxide. Carbon dioxide is chief among the greenhouse gases that are turning our planet into a sauna. Every living thing breathes it out, and it is also released whenever plant matter, including fossil fuels, is burned. The roles of plants and soil. Unique among living things, plants remove carbon dioxide from the air to make their own food during photosynthesis, turning airborne carbon into sugars and starches, locking it away in carbon-rich tissues like wood. When plants die and decay, they become food for decomposing organisms, including soil-dwelling bacteria and fungi, which break down plant matter as they feed on it. This releases some carbon back into the atmosphere as part of a process called the carbon cycle, while the rest is incorporated into the soil and into the bodies of the countless organisms living within it. Soils that are fed annually with organic matter and where digging is minimized will store more carbon than those that are regularly tilled. Every species of garden plant will hoover up carbon dioxide at a different rate, and this varies with temperature, humidity, and rainfall. Fast-growing shrubs and trees are especially good at extracting carbon dioxide from the air, quickly turning it into wood, where it will be locked away for centuries. Saplings, on the other hand, are slow to capture carbon and will only get into their stride when about 5 to 10 years old. A mature tree might draw down 20 to 35 kilograms of carbon dioxide each year, more in tropical regions, the same amount emitted by burning just 10 to 15 litres, that's 2 to 3 gallons of petrol. The carbon cycle. Once plants capture carbon from the air, it is reused repeatedly and even stored, but some is always released back into the air. First, carbon dioxide is absorbed from the air by plants for photosynthesis, and some is released back into the air by living processes in the soil. Oxygen is released as a byproduct of photosynthesis. Dead, carbon-rich plant material is then fed on by soil-dwelling creatures who break it down into soil organic matter, while plant roots actually exude carbon-rich sugars to feed the soil microorganisms, including mycorrhizal fungi. The soil carbon store consists of this soil organic matter in all forms that resist decomposition, and hence it is locked away rather than released. Can plants keep you cool? Wherever trees have been traded for skyscrapers and grasslands for paving and roads, temperatures will invariably be higher. Plants can provide relief by offering shade and a breath of cool, refreshing air. Summer in the city isn't always a nice place to be. Heat builds in expanses of concrete and asphalt to create oppressively hot days and stifling nights. This urban heat island sees as dashing for the comfort of air-conditioned buildings. Adding plants to the situation can reverse some of these effects. Natural climate control. A canopy of leaves that creates shade from the midday sun in summer can make you feel up to 10 to 15 degrees C, that's 18 to 27 degrees Fahrenheit, cooler, while trees to the south and west of a house shield it from the midday and afternoon sun with a cooling effect that could slash air conditioning costs by as much as 50%. But plants offer more than a green parasol. As water evaporates, it lowers temperatures nearby, which is why people flock to fountains and open water in summer. Plants cool the air in a similar way by drawing up moisture from the soil into their leaves, where it gradually evaporates through tiny little pores called stomata on their undersides. This process, which is called transpiration, cools both the plants and the surrounding air in much the same way that sweat cools our skin. Greening turns down the heat. A planted rooftop, also known as a green roof, can have profound cooling effects inside a building. Dark-coloured roofs absorb the sun's energy, but carpeting them with plants exudes cooling moisture and provides a shield from the sun's baking rays. This reduces the summer highs on the roof of 60 degrees C, 140 degrees Fahrenheit, to 30 degrees C, 86 degrees Fahrenheit, and buffers up to 95% of heat that would permeate into the upper floors, reducing the energy needed for indoor cooling by up to 25%. Indoor plants can also have a cooling effect, and the more of them, the better. Green walls festooned with plants are increasingly popular in public and commercial buildings as an environmentally friendly way to improve air quality and lower temperatures. Call it green living in every sense. Transpiration is the process where water is absorbed by roots, moves up through vessels called xylem in the plant from the stem into the leaves, where it evaporates through open pores called stomata, which cools the air around the plant. Roots draw water into their tissue from the surrounding soil to supply this transpiration process. Xylem is the name for the channels within plants that conduct water upwards, as it is lost from the leaves. Stomata are pores on the lower leaf surface that open in daylight, allowing carbon dioxide in and water vapour and oxygen out. Can gardens avert flooding? With increasingly erratic weather, flooding is likely to become a more common event in many areas. Gardens, or a lack of them, play a surprisingly big part in whether extreme rainfall leads to flooding or not. Between 1980 and 2016, the number of storms in Europe doubled and the rate of flooding more than quadrupled. Floods happen when rain falls faster than it can drain away. Paved surfaces can't absorb water, forcing it to flow into drains and gullies, potentially overloading them. On the other hand, garden soil allows water to percolate downwards, taking pressure off drainage systems during storms. Any garden helps to prevent runoff and mitigate the risk of floods. And how well it does this is influenced by the amount of hard landscaping and the type and quality of its soil. Flooding. It's all in the soil. Sandy soils have large particles with generous gaps called pores between them, so water can pass through easily. Clay soils are the opposite, each particle swelling and holding onto water like a sponge, slowing the drainage of rainwater. Soil that has been squashed down or compacted, typically by vehicles, people or animals, is less porous and more liable to flood. In compacted soil, there are no channels between particles for water to drain away. Forking the surface makes only temporary drainage channels, and the best way to prevent water pooling and running off is to nurture a healthy soil structure by minimizing digging and mulching regularly with organic matter. Canopies of leaves also slow the rate at which water strikes the ground, and roots grip the soil, preventing it from washing away. A garden to capture rain. Rain gardens are attractive planted areas designed to slow down and collect water running off paved areas and even roofs during heavy rainfall. Water collects in a basin that has been dug in a well-drained area to prevent water pooling elsewhere in the garden and nearby drains being inundated. They are a simple and effective alternative to more conventional ditch or drainage pipe systems, and are usually cheaper and easier to install. A rain garden is a sunken area of a garden called a basin that is lower than the rest of the garden and surrounded by a raised bank called a berm. It is planted with long-living, perennial plants that are tolerant of occasional flooding. Water from higher areas of the garden, including from roof downpipes, is directed into the basin through a pipe or stone-lined channel. Water in the basin percolates down through free-draining soil. These features can absorb up to 30% more water than a lawn and create a haven for moisture-loving plants. How will climate change affect my garden? The planet is warming and gardeners are on the front line, witnessing firsthand the effects of the changing weather patterns on what they grow. Rather than despair, seize the chance to learn more about plants and hone your gardening skills. Temperatures worldwide have risen by a little over 1 degree C, that's 1.8 degrees Fahrenheit, since humans started burning fossil fuels some 170 years ago. That might sound like the merest of blips on a thermometer, but the consequences are profound, upsetting the fine balance of global weather systems and making extreme weather, like droughts, more common. Shifting the seasons, a risky change. As the planet heats up, spring is arriving earlier in many parts of the globe, causing plants and animals to emerge from their winter hibernation sooner. In the Arctic, spring has advanced 16 days in just a decade. In North America, blueberries.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.